Pujantam Rama Rameti Maduram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibhi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. Sri Ramayana series, part 13. Preparations for coronation. After the auspicious wedding of Sita and Rama, King Dasharatha brought them back to Ayodhya, and it is said that the sons and daughters-in-law of King Dasharatha led a very happy married life at Ayodhya. Sita and Rama were very fond of each other, and the reason that Rama quotes for having so much affection towards Sita is Priyatu Sita Ramasya Daraha Pitrikrita Iti Gunatrupa Gunachyapi Pritibhuyo Bhitvardhate. Rama says, I am fond of Sita because she was the one chosen by my father for me. Actually, he won the hand of Sita by stringing and breaking the bow. Nevertheless, he married her only when his father told him to do so. His devotion towards his father was so much that Lord Rama claimed that his father had found a perfect match for him, and that made him have so much of affinity and affection for Sita. To top it, Sita had all the required qualities and beauty to be adorned as a wonderful, perfect wife. Similarly, Sita too was very fond of the qualities of Rama, and this perfect couple were living a perfect life for almost 12 years at Ayodhya. Then it so happened that one fine day, King Dasharatha happened to look into the mirror, and he suddenly felt that he was aging. He was thousands of years old by then, is what is said in the scriptures. He never felt aged all these years, but suddenly now he felt all signs of aging appearing within him. And he thought that this is the time for me to retire from my duties. This is the time for me to hand over my kingdom to my beloved son Rama, who has all the essential qualities of becoming a great king and carrying on the light of the solar dynasty, which is known for its righteous rule. So saying, he called his ministers and also the citizens of Ayodhya and held a meeting in his royal court to discuss his state of mind, asking them whether they were prepared to have a new king in the form of Rama. As soon as King Dasharatha put forth this proposal, it is said that all of them present there unanimously agreed to the decision of King Dasharatha. They were more than happy to have Rama as their king. Now, when they so willingly accepted this change, King Dasharatha did feel good, but he had a question to ask them. He asked them that, I'm happy that you all are happy with Rama becoming your king, but may I ask you that while I'm ruling this earth with righteousness, you still wish to see Sri Rama as your prince regent? Why like that? I mean, am I not ruling that well that you people are so ready for a change? To this, the citizens of Ayodhya, the ministers of Dasharatha's court, all had fantastic answers. They said, O king, we are absolutely happy with the rule that you are having. The way you are ruling over us, it's wonderful. But we know that Rama is one having superhuman virtues, and which is unquestionably the best even amongst all the sons of Ikshvaku, including you. Rama is somebody so special. Rama is the most righteous man in the world. He is not only truthful, but also solely devoted to truth. Virtue, along with the resultant prosperity, also directly emanates from Sri Rama. So beautifully they phrased these things. They said, Rama Satpurusho Loke Satya Satyaparayanaha Sakshat Ramat Vinirvritto Dharmaschapi Shriyasaha. Not only this, he is somebody who relates so much to us. He feels sorely distressed when he finds us in stress, and he rejoices like a father in all our jubilations. He always utters the truth and has his mind in control. Not only this, he duly accomplishes all the given deeds, and he never relishes arguments or controversies. He is always sweet to talk to. He is called as Mridu Bhashi. He is also Purva Bhashi, meaning he will take an initiative to go and talk to people and give them a good feel. All these he has without having the slightest of head weight or ego. He is capable of ruling the three worlds, what to say just of the earth. If he frowns or favors somebody, it is never purposeless. He always has a reason for whatever he does. He is like the sun of the solar dynasty. He is the best amongst all your ancestors, and raised by you, he is even better than you, O King. So we wish to have the righteous rule of Rama. Thus, enlisting the innumerable qualities of Rama, the citizens of Ayodhya very happily put forth to Dasharatha that they were waiting and wanting this change very, very eagerly. King Dasharatha was more than happy. So he spoke to Sage Vasishtha and requested him to proceed with the required preparations for coronation. Vasishtha was all the more overjoyed to know that it was Rama's coronation. He said that in the following star of Pushya, it would be best to have the coronation of Rama. And he immediately started making preparations for coronation. He summoned all the ministers of Dasharatha, who stood with joined palms in front of the sage and in front of the emperor, and both of them together ordered them to get so many things ready. They said, you get ready all the golden and precious substances which is required for oblation ceremony during installation of Rama as the king. Please go and get white flowers, parched grains of paddy, also honey, ghee, and pieces of brand new cloth. Also have a chariot with all kinds of weapons ready on which Rama can ride and come. Not only this, keep all the doors and gates of the city decorated as beautifully as possible. Let there be sandal paste and garlands all over the city of Ayodhya. Let excellent and wholesome rice cooked in milk or curd be made, and a lakh of brahmanas be fed. Let everybody be given dakshina or charity as much as they want. Let us do this coronation on the most liberal scale. Thus, excitement was building up so much in the court of Dasharatha that even before they told Rama about his coronation, the preparations began in full swing. Then Emperor Dasharatha summoned Rama and told him that it was time for him to take over from his father as a king and continue the righteous rule over Ayodhya and better it if possible. It is said that Prince Rama was the obedient son of Dasharatha, so he did listen to his father immediately. But then Tulsidas ji in his Ramayana tells us the state of mind that Rama was in. Rama was so fond of his brothers that it seems he could not think of taking up the crown for himself when his brothers were around. He says, Janame ek sanga sabha bhai, bhojana sayana kali larikai, karana bedha upabita biyaha, sanga sanga sabha bhaye uchaha, bimala bansayahu anuchita eku, bandhu bihai badehi abhisheku. He said, we all brothers, all four of us, we took birth together, we ate together, slept together, we had our threading ceremony together, we learnt all shastras together, we even got married in the same altar. But now, when it comes to the question of coronation, you people are segregating me from my brothers, saying that I am elder. How is it fair? Tulsidas ji utters these words as were uttered by Rama. Apparently, that was the state of mind that the Lord was in because he was so fond of his brothers. Nevertheless, because he was the obedient son of his father, he did decide to listen to him. And he went to convey this news of his coronation to his mother Kausalya. As he proceeded to the palace of Kausalya, Dasharatha, back in his palace, somehow did not feel good omens prevailing. He somehow felt that things were not going to work out in the expected way. Something was seeming wrong to him all the time. So he requested sage Vasishtha to come to him again, which the sage did. And when Dasharatha told him that he was seeing evil omens, he even told him another important thing. It so happened that at this time, when Dasharatha planned the coronation of Rama, Bharata and Shatrughna were not present at Ayodhya. They had gone to Kekaya Desha, that is the place of their maternal grandfather, on a holiday. King Dasharatha somehow felt that this coronation should happen before the arrival of Bharata. And that would be better. He said, though I know that Bharata is very, very fond of Rama and he would never say anything against Rama becoming a king, still, somehow I feel that there is some ill omen if he would be present during the coronation. So I want it to happen soon. So Sage Vasishtha said, do not worry. We shall have everything hastened up. As such, we have begun the preparations. So we'll see to it that we hasten up the process all the more. And currently, just to ward off any kind of unnecessary turnover of events, let us instruct Rama to stay awake this whole night and perform aradhana or prayer to the presiding deity there. The presiding deity of Lord Narayana was present at Ayodhya, and this form of Lord Narayana was none other than the Lord Ranganatha that we see at Srirangam today. He was present at Ayodhya when Rama had taken incarnation. So, King Dasharatha summoned Rama back and told him to stay awake the whole night, fast, and do prayer to Lord Ranganatha along with Sita Devi. Rama readily agreed to this and went and informed his mother Kausalya about the coronation ceremony and about the instruction of his father to pray to Lord Ranganatha throughout the night. And he went back to his own palace and started performing the aradhana to the Lord. It is said that he performed this aradhana along with Sita Devi, who had beautiful wide eyes. Sahapatnya Vishalaksha Narayanam Upagamat. It is said, along with the wide-eyed Sita, his Dharmapatni, Rama performed this wonderful aradhana of the Lord. And why were the eyes of Sita wide? As such, she had wide, beautiful eyes. But it seems these eyes widened even more because she was so pleased to see her Lord Rama doing service to another Lord, who was none other than a form of his only. It seemed very amusing and nice to her, and her eyes widened to see this scene in front of her. So it is said that she became Vishalakshi, the wide-eyed one, as she saw Rama performing Aradhana to Lord Ranganatha. The couple stayed awake the whole night performing this special prayer. As they were doing this, some other important matter was cooking up elsewhere in the city. What that was, we shall see in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyav Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam.
Sri Ramayana Part 14. Mind Poisoning by Manthara. King Dasharatha felt that he was aging and that his son Rama should take over his reign and become the king of Ayodhya. He found that all the citizens of Ayodhya, all his ministers, all the sages around were all very happy with his decision, and all of them enthusiastically got involved in the preparation of coronation of Rama. But King Dasharatha had perceived some ill omens which indicated that there may be obstacles in the coronation actually happening. Very true to his intuition, something unexpectedly bad was cooking up. Queen Kaikeyi had a maid who was like a foster mother to her, who was a hunchback by the name Manthara. And this Manthara was very fond of Kaikeyi and had moved to Ayodhya along with Kaikeyi when she got married to Dasharatha. This hunchback got to know about the coronation of Rama, and she was not at all happy with that, because she always wanted that Kaikeyi's son Bharata should adorn the throne. And so she rushed to the palace of Kaikeyi to convey this news of coronation of Rama to her. She went to Kaikeyi and she said, "Do you know what is happening? A great work which is ruining you, against which there is no remedy, has commenced now, O Queen," she said. "King Dasharatha is going to install Rama on the throne. Do you see how unjust this is? Whatever is happening here, I don't understand," she said. Now, as soon as the hunchback uttered these words, Kaikeyi was so pleased to hear that she immediately removed her necklace of gems and gave it to her as a present. She was so fond of Rama. Kaikeyi was more fond of Rama than she was of Bharata himself. She was so happy to hear the news of Rama's coronation that she congratulated Manthara and expressed her happiness to the fullest. And Manthara was all the more annoyed to see Kaikeyi's reaction. She said, "What is wrong with you? I mentally laugh at you that even after meeting such a great calamity, you feel rejoiced. When there is a reason to mourn, you are actually trying to throw happiness-laden laughter into the air such that it reaches miles. You're so happy. Whatever is wrong with you? Do you understand what is happening? Please wake up." And she shakes up Kaikeyi. Even after the hunchback does this, Kaikeyi tells her that, "You know how Rama is. Dharmagnyo gunavan dantaha kritagnyaha satyavachuchihi Ramo Rajasuto Jeshto Yavarajya Mataurhati. Rama is Dhanmagnya. Rama is Gunavan. Rama is Danta. Rama is Kritagnya. Rama is Satyavan. And Rama is Shuchi. Means what? Rama is the one who knows Dharma. He is Dharmagnya. He is Gunavan. He is the one filled with auspicious qualities. He is Danta. He is the one who is bounteous. He is Kritagnya. He is the grateful one. He is Satyavan. He is the truthful one. He is Shuchi. He is the pure one. Who other than Rama is eligible for taking over the throne? He is also the eldest son of the emperor. So, what is wrong in the emperor having made a decision about making Rama the king? He is the one eligible for the throne. He is the one who will take care of his brothers and even his servants as a father will take care of his children. Then what is the reason for you to feel distressed, O hunchback? Why are you reacting like this? And if you feel Bharata should get the throne, please do not worry. After hundreds of years of Rama's installation, when Rama retires due to old age, he will definitely pass over the throne to Bharata, the next brother of his. So that way, my son will also inherit the ancestral throne. So what is the problem now? Why cannot this coronation go on as it is? This is a wonderful news that you have given me. To this, the hunchback Manthara could not understand Kaikeyi's reaction and she actually put her head against her forehead and sat down. She said, Kaikeyi, you're not perceiving the danger that is hiding. You know, today everybody gives you a lot of respect. That is because you're the favorite queen of the king. The king gives you preference over other queens. And so, you are held in high esteem by everybody. Now, tomorrow, if Rama becomes the king, then Dasharatha will also start concentrating more on Rama's mother Kausalya than you. So, that way, you will be in danger. Kausalya will start getting more importance than you do. And one more thing. If Rama takes over the throne, then his potential threat would be Bharata. Because Bharata being the next brother, he may think that Bharata will compete for his throne and expect any kind of danger from him at any time. So he may want to do away with Bharata. What if he does that? What if he wants to get rid of Bharata forever? Then what will happen? You lose your son. You lose your dignity in the emperor's eyes. You lose your importance in the kingdom and you may even lose your son. Saying such things, this evil-minded hunchback succeeded in poisoning the mind of Kaikeyi. She started believing that what the hunchback said was the truth. And once she started believing this, she said, Oh, my foster mother, oh Manthara, you have really opened my eyes. I never thought from this point of view. I need to reward you. Let me give you this golden necklace. And at that time, she handed over her golden necklace to this Manthara, it seems. See what turn of events. When man's mind gets poisoned, he starts feeling even the evil is beautiful and the evil is his big support. That is only an indication that bad times are befalling that person. Kaikeyi went a step ahead and said that if you will tell me what is to be done to prevent this coronation, if you can save me from this disastrous situation, I promise to adorn your entire body with golden jewels. Atrateham prameekshami malam kumche hiranmayim abhishikte cha bharate raghave cha vanam gate jatyena cha suvarnena sunischitena sundari. She's calling out to the hunchback as Sundari, the beautiful one. And she says, I will ensure that you get decorated with jewels throughout if you will give me an option to do away with this current situation. Manthara had her options ready. She told Kaikeyi, see, you only have to do one thing. The emperor owes you two boons. As the boons, you can ask the emperor to first
send Rama on exile to the forest for 14 years and second to coronate Bharata instead of Rama. So if you do these two, then your entire problem will be solved. You will have Bharata as the king also. And if you have Rama present while Bharata is being crowned, then Rama can become a threat to Bharata. So if you send him away to the forest, then that problem of Rama being a threat to Bharata will also get solved automatically. So this is what you need to do. So Kaikeyi becomes completely clear in her clouded mind that Rama is a threat to Bharata and Rama should not be coronated at any cost at this time. So she decides to ask the emperor for these two boons. Now, why would the emperor grant these boons to Kaikeyi? She was sure he will grant these boons to her because of a particular reason, which we shall get to know in the next part. And she was also sure that even otherwise, the emperor would have to yield to her because he liked her a lot. She was his favorite queen. So she expected that the emperor would definitely listen to her. So then she made up her mind as to how to execute this plan which was given by her well-wisher Manthara, who had successfully poisoned her mind now. She thought she would go and sit in the dark room. Normally, these queens would go and sit in that dark room when they were angry or when they want something, when they wanted something to happen for sure, when they were adamant on something to be happening, they would go and sit in this dark room. So Kaikeyi went and sat in that dark room. She removed all her jewels, all finery. She unbraided her hair, left it open, and she slept on the floor, waiting for the king to come. She knew it was time for the king to come. He was to visit her at that time. So at that time, she went and lay in that room. Emperor Dasharatha walked into her palace and she was normally the one who would come running to receive the king. Today, she was nowhere to be seen. The emperor went looking for her throughout the palace. Ultimately, he found her in that dark room. Very surprised he was. He thought that she would have got the news of coronation of Rama and would be overjoyed now. And to see her in this condition was really shocking to the emperor. He went near her and took her in his laps and asked her, "What is wrong with you? Did anybody make fun of you? Did anybody mock at you? Are you not well? Is your health not okay? Or are you upset with me? Have I done something wrong to you? Please open up and tell me, O queen. I cannot bear to see you like this anymore." At this time, Kaikeyi said, "You have to promise me to do whatever I ask of you. Only if you do that will I tell you what I am upset with." The emperor was so upset looking at the queen that he said, "Do not worry. I promise I shall do whatever you want. Your happiness is all that I want in my life. I want to keep you happy. And to see you distressed like this in the dark room is intolerable to me. Please ask, O queen, whatever you want." At this time, Kaikeyi said she wanted two boons of the king. She wanted the king to grant her two boons which he had promised to grant years ago. What were the boons that she asked and what was the reason behind the king promising to give her these two boons? We shall get to know in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjanasute Tatvam Munibhyaparam Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi parivritam Ramam bhajeshyamalam. Shri Ramayana, Part 15. Boons sought for the sake of Bharata or us. That's the title of today's lecture. We saw that Emperor Dasharatha had decided to crown Rama as Prince Regent, and the entire city of Ayodhya rejoiced with this decision, except for the hunchback Manthara, who successfully poisoned the mind of Kaikeyi against this decision of King Dasharatha. And Kaikeyi wanted her way out, so she became adamant and went and lay down in that dark room, removing all her ornaments and sleeping on the floor with open hair. When King Dasharatha came and inquired the reason for this distress of his queen, she told him that if he promised to give her what she wanted, she would ask of him. When he promised, she reminded him of the two boons that he had decided to grant to her once upon a time. Now, what was the reason for this episode? How did it happen that the king granted two boons to the queen, which she wanted to redeem now? It so happened that King Dasharatha had gone to assist the Devas against the Asuras in a war in heaven. He went there and fought on behalf of the Devas. While fighting, he had taken Kaikeyi along with him. Kaikeyi was an excellent charioteer, it seems. She was adept at driving the chariot, and so she had accompanied the king for this war. It so happened that during the war, the wheel of King Dasharatha's chariot lost its nail, the nail which fixes the spokes of the wheel to the center was lost. So Kaikeyi put her finger in place of the nail and held the wheel in place so that King Dasharatha did not get hurt by the enemies till he steadied himself. So she prevented great danger to the king during that war against the Asuras when Dasharatha supported the Devas. And at this time, being pleased with Kaikeyi, the king had granted her two boons. And Kaikeyi said, I want you to grant me these two boons now. King Dasharatha readily agreed. He said, of course, you had told me that you did not want to take the boons right at that time and you would use these boons whenever you wanted. And now you are telling me you want these boons to be granted. I will grant them. But please spell out the boons. What do you want me to grant? To this, Kaikeyi very viciously said, I do not want this coronation of Rama. Instead, I want him to be sent on exile to the forest for 14 years. That's the first boon I seek of you. Secondly, I want Bharata to be installed on the throne instead of Rama. You have to grant me these two boons. This is what she said. The emperor actually swooned away listening to this. He fell unconscious. He was unable to take this. It was like a heart attack coming to him. He felt so bad that he was speechless. He told her, O cruel woman of wicked conduct, you're bent upon exterminating my race. What wrong has been done to you? How can you even think of sending Rama away to the forest? I can forsake anything for you. I can forsake my other two wives, Kausalya and Sumitra, my fortune, my wealth, my kingdom, but certainly not Rama. He's my soul. And he's so fond of you. He's more fond of you than his own mother, Kausalya. How can you think bad for him? Why can't you please give up this sinful resolve of yours? What makes you think like this? Please do not say such harsh words and take back your seeking of these boons. I cannot grant you these boons. To this, Kaikeyi used even more cruel words and actually spoke about the king with disgust. She even spoke very, very badly about the lineage of the king, the solar dynasty itself. And she said that if you will not grant these boons to me, then you would bring defame to your entire dynasty by not keeping up your word. To this, the king had no answer to be given, and he just felt miserable and helpless. It is said that this queen of King Dasharatha was a Mahishi indeed. Srinidhi Swami says in his Manju Ramayana that this queen was a Mahishi. Now, Mahishi in Sanskrit means queen and also means she buffalo. This queen Kaikeyi was like a she buffalo to this emperor, says Swami. Why? Because she buffaloes are very dirty. So also this queen had a lot of dirt in her mind. Not only that, she buffaloes are very fond of playing in puddles which are formed by stagnant water. So also this queen Kaikeyi was responsible for bringing out puddles of tears in the eyes of the king. Not only that, very soon the entire city of Ayodhya was going to be in tears because of this decision of hers. Not only that, she buffaloes have two horns. Similarly, this queen Kaikeyi asked two horn-like boons or varas, which were fearful and disgusting to look at. Indeed, she is like a dirty-minded she buffalo. Saying a pun like this, Swami writes a shloka which is as follows: Janabashpa jalashaya priya varashringa dvaya bhima darshana malina mati mandya pivara mahishi satyamiyam mahipate. This queen Kaikeyi is fond of Janabashpa jalashaya, meaning the ponds of water, puddles of water which are formed by tears of people. And she has two horns with her, which are nothing other than the two boons that she asked for. Varashringa dvaya bhima darshana. And she has a dirty mind. Malina mati mandya pivara. Indeed, this queen is a Mahishi, like a she buffalo. Mahishi satyamiyam mahipate. Like this, dirty boons were asked of the king by this she buffalo like queen. And very helplessly, Dasharatha summoned Rama to Kaikeyi's palace. He did not know what to say, but he had no other choice but to yield to Kaikeyi. So with the heaviest of hearts, he called for Rama. As soon as Rama received this message, it seems he came with complete enthusiasm. He thought Kaikeyi was calling her to give him some instructions about the coronation. Because she was so fond of him and he was also so fond of her. So he went very affectionately to meet Mother Kaikeyi. He thought Mother Kaikeyi is calling him. And as he reached Kaikeyi's palace, the sight that met his eyes was really shocking. He saw his father in a swoon state and his mother Kaikeyi lying down in a very unsightful manner. It was really not a sight worth seeing. He was very surprised and he went and asked his father, "Father, what makes you so distressed? Why am I seeing you like this? Whenever I come to see you, you come rushing to welcome me. Today, on the contrary, you're lying like this as though something very serious has happened. What is the matter, father? How can I help you? Please tell me." His father was unable to reply. King Dasharatha had no words to tell Rama. So Kaikeyi intervened and said that, "Rama, your father will tell you what he wants only if you promise that you will do what he asks." To this, Rama replied, "Bhakshayeyam visham tikshnam pateyam apicharnave niyukto guruna pitra nripena cha hitena cha." "O queen, if my father tells me to drink poison, I shall drink. If he tells me to jump into the ocean, I will. I will do anything that he tells me to do. He is my father, he is my preceptor, and he is the king.
and he will only think right for me. I am destined and bound to listen to whatever he says. And trust me, whatever I say is the truth. I shall not speak otherwise. Karishye pratijane cha Ramo durnabhibhashate. Rama has no two tongues. So if I say I will do, I will do. Please tell me what I am supposed to do. To this, Kaikeyi told him about the boons that his father was forced to grant, and because of which he had to go an exile to the forest for 14 years and Bharata was to be installed on the throne. Rama very happily smiled and said, "Of course, I will carry out my father's orders without a second thought." And Tulsidas ji describes in his Tulsi Ramayana that the state of mind of Rama at that time was like that of an elephant which was freed of iron chains. It seems when the coronation was planned for Rama, he felt so bad that his brothers were not getting coronated and he was to get coronated, that he felt that he was being bound into iron shackles. And as soon as he received this news that he doesn't have to get coronated anymore and has to move to the forest, he felt that his shackles were broken. Navagayandu Raghubira Manu Raju Alana Samana Chut Jani Bana Gavanu Suni Ura Anandu Adhikana, says Tulsi Dasji. He felt like a free elephant who was freed of iron shackles. So he felt so good about it. And he just said that I shall definitely fulfill my father's words. He has given you a word of granting you two boons, and that word of his shall be protected by me. So I shall do Pitruvakya Paripalana, he said. I shall safeguard the words of my father and go to the forest. Kaikeyi was cruel to tell him that you should do it right now. In fact, till you do it, your father shall not drink a drop of water, she said. So Rama said, "Yes, mother, I will definitely go right away. Let me just tell a word to my mother Kausalya and wife Sita and then I depart," he said, very willingly, to which Kaikeyi agreed. And Rama went to Kausalya's palace. Kausalya had received the news of coronation before. So she was making mighty preparations for the coronation. She was so happy. She was giving away so many gifts in charity. And Rama reached. She was very happy to welcome Rama to her palace. But then Rama told her that this is the case. There is not going to be any coronation of mine tomorrow. Instead, I am going to the forest. Kausalya Devi was shattered to listen to this. She said, "I have been going through this for a long time, that the emperor finally listens to Kaikeyi, whatever she says. And many a time she doesn't say right. And this time it is gravely wrong. Oh Rama, I do not want you to rule the kingdom, but I cannot bear to be separated from you. It's okay. Let's give up the kingdom. You don't take up the kingdom. Let Bharata become the king. But please do not go to the forest. Please stay with me. Nobody in this kingdom has to support you but me. We shall go and live not in the palace but in some outskirts of the city. I shall go and work in four houses, earn money and support your livelihood. But please be with me, my son. Please do not go to the forest," she said. Rama was moved by the way his mother reacted. He felt very bad. And Kausalya Devi further went ahead to tell him a point of dharma. It is said that if your father says something, you have to listen. But if your mother says something otherwise, it is more wise to listen to your mother. In fact, it is expected that you overrule your father's commands to your mother's commands and you listen to her. So now your father has commanded you to go to the forest. But I am saying you do not go to the forest. And it will be only righteous on your part to listen to your mother instead of your father in this case. Because Rishi Apastamba has said, Matetyeke means what is said by the mother is the ultimate sentence and there is none who is greater than the mother. So, finally you can listen to your mother whatever she says.
So please take that dharma into account and listen to me and stay back. Rama caught hold of the hand of his mother and said, "Oh mother, I understand your state of mind and your plight, but please listen to what I have to submit to you. You told me a point of dharma, that's fine. But if today I listen to your wish and stay back here, which is an easier thing for me to do than going to the forest, then everybody on earth will use my example as an excuse to listen to the mother in order to make a convenient decision. And they will make the mother give them an order to make a conducive decision, a convenient decision. So I do not want to be a bad example to the world, just to use dharma to my own convenience. It will be very convenient for people to overrule their father's commands and make their mother tell whatever they want to do. They will use this as an excuse. That's fine. That day, even Rama overruled his father and listened to his mother. So I can also do so. So I do not want to set a bad example, mother," he said. "Secondly, father is elder to both you and me. So it is only becoming of both of us to listen to whatever he says. It may be right for me to listen to you, but it is certainly not right for you to talk against him. So being his devoted wife, Dharmapatni, you should give instructions in accordance to what father has given." So saying, Rama established the right way of looking at righteousness here. That is why he is called as Dharmagna. And he is called as Dharmagna even by Kaikeyi, who completely was devoid of dharma at this point of time. So this conduct of righteousness was shown by Rama to the world through this episode. So the boons sought by Kaikeyi were actually for the sake of Bharata. But because she sought these boons, the world got to know so many teachings. The entire Ramayana follows because the Lord went to the forest. And he went to the forest because of these boons sought by Kaikeyi. So actually, Kaikeyi seems to have sought boons for our sake instead of Bharata's sake. Because Bharata finally never used the boons that Kaikeyi sought for him. So ultimately, it is to teach us the path of righteousness that these boons were actually useful for. So Rama thus showed the path of righteousness to his own mother and through her to us. And once Kausalya listened to these wisdom-laden words of her son, she was so proud of her son. She said, "All that I can give you now is an armor of blessing. So here I bless you, my son. Yampalayasi dharmam stvam krithya cha niyamena cha savai raghavashar dula dharmaswam abhirakshatu. May this righteousness dharma that you are following now always be followed by you, and may that dharma itself be your protector." Saying this, Kausalya Devi gave him an armor of protection of righteousness and sent him willingly to the forest. As an effect of these boons, many more things followed, which we shall listen to in the next part.